I love our theme song. I really do.
Yeah?
It's every time I listen, because it's like game film for me. Every time I, pretty much right after this show, I'll listen to the show. And I know it's a good show if I can get through the whole thing. There have been shows where I've just been like, God, I suck. And I can't get through the whole thing. But I just, every time I listen to the theme, when I imagine this show, I wanted a kick-ass rock theme that introduced you and said, okay, here's an in-your-face, you know, internet radio, podcast, whatever the hell you want to call it, show that's going to tell it how it is, and that song hits it right on the head. Thank you very much again to Turnpike Gardens for that one, because right now you're listening to the Mike Sasson Show live on the River's Edge. You can listen to us live at www.riversedgepgh.com or on TuneIn Radio, or right now you're watching me and producer extraordinaire Alex right over there.
Hey.
On Facebook Live, or eventually on YouTube, or on the Google Play, or on the SoundCloud, or on the iTunes.
I'm actually watching us right now on full screen, which I don't usually do while we're doing the show.
Okay.
And it's kind of weird.
Yeah, I wouldn't do that.
Looks good, though.
Oh, I mean, half looks good, yeah. But
yeah.
The one with Alex.
The
looks
right
good.
Half.
Yeah. Yeah. The right half. The left half is it, the right half is there to balance out the left half.
The left half is sadly larger.
Not you
as a person.
Well, I mean. it is sadly larger, but we go from there. Hey, again, welcome back to the world. It's the post Thanksgiving show. Still, we are all in a tryptophan induced haze. I think that's the chemical in turkey, right?
Yeah.
Good. I thought of that as an opening, and then I was like, I hope I have that chemical right. And then a part of me said, well, Mike, why don't you Google it? And then I just went back to sleep.
Wonder how they came up with the name for that.
You know what? There's a...
Someone fell.
It's probably something
that it made.
It's probably something in Latin. That is something that I always think about, is like everything around you has a name, and some person had to come up with that name. And then we just forget that that's what, you know, then you get real philosophical. Like, you know, if it, you know, this is a table, why is it a table? And there's people who study this, you know, linguists who go back in time and figure out why is this called a table? And it's called a table only in certain parts of the world. In other parts of the world, it's, you know, it's called something else.
A tableau.
Yeah. It's weird. If you really think about it, that's a very weird thing, our language. Because we are, it also points out the fact that we're only recently that connected to each other, that there even is different languages.
Oh.
Because for most of human history, we just were in these little groups, and so we all decided what this was a table, and this was a microphone, and these were hands, and I'm a person, you know, the name. You know, we're all our names. And then somewhere else in some other tribe, they came up with their own name for it. Another place, they came up with their own name for it. Another place, they came up with their own name for it. I mean, even in the United States. I mean, when I went up to Connecticut and I wanted, like, a hoagie. And I said, can I have a hoagie? And they looked at me weird. And then I had to figure out that it's called a grinder up there.
Ew.
And then some other place.
That sounds dirty.
Yeah. Well, I thought a grinder, I'm a big hockey fan, so that's like a player who doesn't score a lot of goals.
Oh, I was thinking of the app.
Of the app? Well, so, at the time, the app didn't
exist.
That
wasn't a thing.
But that could confuse some new kid from Pittsburgh up there. It's like, hey, you know, you want to get a grinder? And I'm just like, I don't know.
No.
You're a little forward. But and then some other place, it's a sub. And all that. And again, that's in the United States. But that brings it up, that how much mass communication has changed everything. That's what you wanted to hear on Tuesday morning. Because I was also thinking of the fact that this show, in my opinion, is a service. It's what we do for you, the listening, viewing public. And that's why I love Tuesday, having it on Tuesday, because this is the roughest day of the week.
Is it?
I believe so, because it's where the Monday, you at least have some of the goodness of the weekend, especially this weekend. Most people took a long weekend. Most people were off Friday, so you have a little bit of that. Monday, you still have a little bit of that sheen on you, that happiness. Now you're into the bottom. Then you're like, oh my God, it's Tuesday.
I think Wednesday's the hardest day, at least for me.
Wednesday, I've always felt, is I can at least see, once you're past Wednesday, like about noon. Like they call it hump day for a reason. You get over the hump. And so once you get it, or you're having sex constantly. Those are the two reasons why on Wednesday it's called hump day. But once you get past noon, then it, to me, it's like, all right, going downhill. I can almost see the weekend. And then Thursday might as well be Friday. Because then they got football now on Thursday, and you know, usually Thursday for years has been the best television day because they always put great television on Thursday because of the fact of people go shopping over the weekend, so all the ads are on Thursday. That's why they always for years put the best programs on Thursday, so Thursday was always a happy day. And then Friday everyone's just trying to get the hell out of there. But Tuesday, there's nothing special going on. So right now, you're coming off the holiday weekend. You need something to get you through Tuesday. That's what this show is right now, to get you through Tuesday.
I feel like you have a lot more gestures today than usual. That's surprising. You have a lot to begin with, and I feel like it's even more today.
I'm just trying to get through Tuesday. I'm just trying to. Sometimes when people see me perform, they go, wow, you have a lot of energy. Yeah, I create it sometimes just because... I need to get excited that I'm up there. and I don't want to mail anything in. So, but if you're listening right now and you're at work, or it's past Tuesday and you still need to get through work, that's what this is for. Today, we're going to be talking about how you win at social media. I'm going to give you a multiple point plan. And if you ever want to win in social media, how you need to do it. We're going to recap our Thanksgivings and ask the eternal question. Are holidays better when you were a kid or now that you're a grown-up? Unless you're a kid right now and you're listening to this, in which case, congratulations, you know, you slipped one past the goaltender, which I'm for. You listen to it. Fine. If you're a kid, learn something. Also, we're going to be doing the top five. The top five are the top five excuses why people give why they're not doing what they want to be doing, or why they failed in their lives, and I'm going to debunk all of them. And also, we're going to have a jam-packed news and notes. When I was working on this show, the first
jam packed.
The first half of the show was actually more difficult because there were so many just weird stories. I had to group one of them together, some news and notes stories, into one because there was like three of the essentially the same type of story, which was dick pics and nudity gone awry. So that'll be another story we'll do later in the day.
We should have a compilation of all the times that we talk about dick pics.
Half of the internet are dick pics gone awry, or nudity gone awry. Because I really think that's the one thing about the internet that people haven't really learned yet, is how to handle taking pictures of themselves nude and the appropriate way to distribute them. We haven't figured it out. We're going to figure it out on today's show. That's how we do it. So, moving forward, Thanksgiving recap. The reason why I brought up the whole point of, like, were holidays better when you were a kid or where you were now, is we had Thanksgiving here, and fine holiday, love turkey, love stuffing, love the carbs, love, you know, the pie, all that kind of good stuff, had all the fixings, all that kind of stuff. But this was the first Thanksgiving in which a decent percentage of the family now living outside of Pittsburgh was not able to get back. My brother John stayed in Los Angeles. My brother Matt came to Pittsburgh but didn't spend it here. He spent it with his girlfriend.
Ugh.
We'll talk about that. But my sister Beth stayed in New York City and New Jersey and went with the husband's parents, and my sister Meg stayed in Virginia. So there was only like me, my sister Bridget, who's the lawyer downtown, my brother, my sister-in-law, and then her kids, and then my mom and her fiance.
That's weird, because I had the very opposite, where usually my siblings are not there, mm-hmm. and this year both of them were there, which is rare. Well, haven't been like that for probably 6-7 years.
Yeah, I mean, but it gets especially more difficult, and you'll find this, when they now have significant others, like they get married and stuff.
Yeah.
Because then you get to the point to where like they have their own families and their own traditions, right. and all that kind of good stuff. And so I kind of had this, you know, thought, like I enjoyed myself. I'm one of these people that enjoys where I am right now. I don't look back. I don't sit there and go, man, if I was 18 again, man, if I was 21 again, man, I don't do that. I'm happiest right now. I believe I'm as bad. I'm as good as I've ever been, which is not real good, but I'm as good as I've ever been. I'm as good looking as I've ever been. I feel as good as I've ever been. And so I don't look back and go, man, I wish I was, you know, 18 again where I didn't know anything. And, you know, I didn't have any control over my life, all that kind of good stuff where, you know, a lot of people like to look back on their past. But this past Thanksgiving, I had this thought of, you know, we used to have the eight kids, and the eight kids would always be around the table. And when you were a kid, it wasn't that big a deal because, you know, no one was married, no one lived outside of town. And so it was just, hey, Thanksgiving, you'd show up and it'd just be a big meal that you'd have on a Thursday. And so is it better now that you have a little bit more control over the situation, or was it better when you were a kid? And also extends to other holidays.
Right.
You know, was Christmas better when you were a kid, or is Christmas better now? Is, you know, was, you know, were the other holidays, you know, the tier two. That's what I view. The tier one holidays are Christmas and Thanksgiving.
Oh, okay.
Those are the tier one holidays. Okay. Big time holidays.
Okay.
Like when you say the reason why you could say that's the holiday season.
Right.
The holiday season, at least in my mind, goes from Thanksgiving through, you know, Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, Christmas, to New Year's, which is just about drinking and football.
Right.
And then finally to the Super Bowl.
Yes.
The Super Bowl is finally when the holiday season is over. It's got to the point that here's the Sasson family tradition. We do not take the tree down until the Steelers are eliminated from the playoffs. And okay. Yes, we have watched the Super Bowl this first week of February, and there's a tree still in the corner.
That's okay.
Yeah, that's the Sasson family tradition. We do not touch any of the Christmas ornaments until the Steelers, because that officially ends any sort of joy that we have for the year. But I ask you, Alex, which do you believe? Are you on team now, or are you on team when you were a kid?
See, I have arguments for both. I think some of it is better now because you have alcohol. That really, really puts me in the mood for the holidays.
Yeah, you're a gigantic fan of the alcohol. So that's one thing I thought about.
Yeah, I love, like, this Thanksgiving, I stupidly made cinnamon rolls, and it took me all day. But I had some wine, and that made it a little bit better. So, yeah, I think alcohol really makes holidays better, especially if you're trying to bond with your older relatives. I feel like alcohol makes that just a little bit easier.
So you're going to team. You're going to team now because of alcohol, then.
But food-wise, I feel like it was better as a child because you could eat anything that you want and not have any repercussions afterwards. You know what I mean?
You didn't fear about getting sick. You didn't worry about weight. You didn't worry about any of that kind of stuff.
Exactly. You're not like, oh, maybe I shouldn't eat that cookie. You know?
That is a big deal.
Yeah, that's because a big deal for me. I like food a lot, and sometimes it doesn't agree with me.
Well. That is one thing that is happening. If there's anything that's happening at my advanced age, is now I am noticing that, you know, I obviously am a lot smaller than I used to be, but sadly people are looking on the Facebook like how big was this guy? Yeah, I've lost over 100 pounds, and so the other thing is that now that was a residue of the younger me of like, oh, I can eat anything. I can have two Whoppers in a pie and everything, and that'll be like my snack before lunch. No one cares. That's what happens when you keep doing that as an adult. And so, yeah, I'm very cognizant of how many calories I'm putting in me. And also I'm cognizant of the fact that if I have a big meal, it's going to be a couple days of some irregular bowel movements and some flatulence and some all that kind of stuff. Whereas, yeah, when you're a kid, you're just like, I'll eat every piece of pie
and
there
you
is.
You just want to fall asleep after a big meal. Like when you're a kid, you have all the energy in the world. That means nothing, you know? Eating a big meal would do nothing to you. You're going to go and, you know, go crazy afterwards still.
And that is why, to bring up another point, why it's on team younger is better than team older is, for a couple years when I worked at Sears, we were open on Thanksgiving night.
Ugh.
Which meant that we'd have like the Thanksgiving meal at 4 p.m. I would have to show up to the store at like 6, and then I'd stay up all night and I wouldn't get back to my house until like 8 a.m. So imagine having your Thanksgiving meal and then you want to go to sleep, but there's hundreds of people yelling at you wanting to know where the Dyson vacuums are.
See, I took a nap after our meal, and then I also went to sleep at like 9 o'clock. So.
Now, most people, I've actually read that the tryptophan thing actually is kind of a fantasy. That you just consume so much and it's been a long day that you just kind of go to sleep. Yeah. But so my answer is, overall point wise, I'd have to say holidays were better when you were a kid. Christmas definitely was better when you were a kid. Christmas was wet because you got more toys and it was a big deal. Now, for about 10 years, it didn't mean anything. Now with the young nieces, now that I get to go back into, you know, to Toys R Us and get them stuff. Christmas has made a little bit of a rebound, but back, you know, for about 10 years when none of us had kids or anything like that, all Christmas became was like Thanksgiving with a tree and you got a book.
See, I disagree because like, even though, yeah, obviously it's great to have presents when you're little and you have all these cool toys and stuff. Now, every year I have more and more money to buy my family stuff, which makes me very happy. Like, I love watching people open presents. So now I have more money every year, hopefully, and I can buy them more stuff.
Here's why it's a little different with me because
I am not a good person.
No, I am the best gift giver. I am so good at it. Because here's the thing.
You remember everything.
So if you say in July, like, you know what, I really like that thing in July. I remember that and I bring it up then. But the thing is then no one else has my memory. So then they come up with me like, I don't know what to get Mike. I don't know. And so eventually I just get like a gift card. And so I'm like, and I appreciate the gift card. I always like money. But on one hand, I'm like, I gave you a very thoughtful gift. I'm sitting in the middle of the mall, you know, trying to find the perfect thing because I remember you like this, you know, this t-shirt, or you like this movie, or you like this book or whatever. And, or, you know, you particularly like shopping at this place and blah, 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 blah. And then, you know, you get me, you know, a chill pillow. And I'm just
what
like,
what the hell is that?
Yeah. I mean, I'm just like, oh, thanks. Okay. That took zero effort, but
maybe they knew that you like,
I've never opened it. I've never opened it. Like last year it actually got to me. Cause like, my brother got me DVDs and I'm like, I don't have a DVD player. And I'm just like, and I'm like, and he's like, I'll get you a DVD player.
Open your next gift. It's a DVD player.
That is always the funny one. When I was a little kid, whenever you got the game system,
you always got the games first.
You always got the games first.
Yeah.
And then like my mom would still be like, you don't know if you got the game system. I'm like, well, then you're an idiot if you just got the games. But to end it all, I believe holidays were better as a kid. Thanksgiving especially, because again, you could eat anything you want. You weren't sitting there thinking about calories and you didn't have weird bowel movements for the next week. Christmas, obviously better because of toys. And
I disagree because of alcohol.
But you agree all of those things are true.
Oh, yeah.
But you're saying alcohol trumps everything. Yep. Now, if you were drinking alcohol when you were 12, then...
Well, I mean, I was when I was 12, but you know.
That's why we love Alex, producer extraordinaire, right over there. Moving on.
It's the only reason.
All right. Been thinking about this. This was actually something that just happened today. So I'm driving in to do the show, and I'm listening on my Sirius to Howard Stern. And they have a guy calling in, and they're talking about there's a big deal that the Walking Dead, the show on AMC, premiere episode had 17 million viewers.
Okay.
This past episode, it got down to 11.
Oh, I thought you meant 11 viewers.
Yeah, 11 viewers. 11 million. Okay. No, it's down to 11 people.
That would suck.
16,998,000 people told it.
You failed.
You sucked. This sucked. No, it went down to 11 million people. But still, that's 6 million people who saw the initial episode who went, this sucks, I'm not watching it. Okay?
Okay.
Double the population of Metro Pittsburgh basically said, this show sucks, I'm not watching it.
Okay.
And they're trying to figure out why. And they have like, oh, they killed, you know, some popular characters, blah, blah, blah. They don't like the new bad guy, all this kind of stuff. So I'm listening to Howard Stern and they're going over all these things. And one guy calls up and he goes, I don't like the interracial relationships.
Oh.
And it kind of got me because it reminds me of a couple instances that I've had where, you know, people have kind of come up to you and given you reasons why they hate something, and you know, like, it's okay to hate something. You can hate anything you want. You can watch any TV show. You can watch anything you want. But when, you know, when it's for an idiotic, you know, especially racist reason, it just ticks you off to no end. Like, right. One time I was outside of a comedy show in, like, middle of central Pennsylvania. I do pretty well. So afterwards, you know, you're trying, you know, you're sitting around and people come up to you and go, hey, that was great. And
you're schmoozing.
You're schmoozing. And yeah, you're the hotel greeter. You're going, hey, thank you very much. So this couple comes up to me and this guy comes up to me and goes, hey, yeah, you're funny. I really liked you. I go, oh, thank you very much. He goes, but I got a question for you. And I'm like, well, what's your question? He goes, why didn't you make fun of N-words? And he didn't say N-words.
What?
Yeah. And I was so taken back. The only thing I could say, why?
What are you saying?
But he was literally like, really like I was sitting there in my seat wondering why this comedian isn't making fun of my least favorite race. And I'm just like, I take back your liking me. I really was driving back to Pittsburgh after this show going, I need to change my entire act if that guy likes me.
Right.
And then another thing happened this past weekend. I'm in the mall and I'm watching TV and there's, you know, multiple football games on. And one of them is the Dolphins versus the 49ers. It's the end of the game. And Colin Kaepernick is, you know, trying to bring the 49ers back and score a tying touchdown.
Right.
And so this guy comes moseying up to me. Don't really know him. Don't really know him. It's just moseys up to me. He goes, I hate Colin Kaepernick. And I'm just like, okay, you know, whatever. My stance, and I've brought it up on this show, Colin Kaepernick can say anything he wants. It doesn't bother me. Whatever. That's your opinion. Go ahead. But this past week, he did a couple things. One, he said that Fidel Castro was essentially a cool guy because he's dead. And I think that's stupid because he was a tyrant. But again, you have the right to be an idiot. And then the second thing he said was, he obviously going to Miami, large Cuban dissident population, so he wasn't very popular there. So this guy sits there and goes, I don't like the fact that he doesn't stand for the American flag. I'm like, okay, that's your right, whatever. That he said the nice things about Fidel Castro. And I'm like, yeah, you're right. He shouldn't say that. But again, you have a right to your opinion. And then the third thing he says, and I don't like that he's now a Muslim. And I was taken back because I view myself as a pretty good sports fan, and I don't remember Colin Kaepernick becoming a Muslim. And so literally, I Googled it while I was there. It's like, is Colin Kaepernick a Muslim? And like, it went back like, no.
That exact response.
Yeah, the Google just looked at me and went, no.
Why would you even ask this?
Yeah, but I mean, like, and I'm sitting there and I'm looking at this guy and I'm like, okay, so he hates this guy.
Wait, did you tell the guy though?
Nah, he just like, I didn't even want to talk to the guy.
Okay,
and
right.
So I didn't want to correct.
Did you say anything back to him or you just like?
No, I just was like, yeah. Like that drift off thing. You're like, yeah.
Okay.
And then, but it gets back to this whole point of whenever you, like when you do this show, or you do comedy or anything like that, people give you advice. And a lot of people have come up to me about this show and they've said, you know, Mike, I love the show. You know, Alex is great. You're mediocre, but you know, whatever. And they sit there and be like, but you know, I saw you did this story and you know, that's a little risque and I don't know if you want to do that. Or, you know, if you want to get bigger audiences, you gotta, you know, have XYZ guests or blah, blah, blah. And the point being that I bring up all of these things is the simple fact of the matter is like the only person I know for a fact enjoys this show is me. I can't look into anybody else's brain. I run it by Alex, and if Alex has any issues, she can bring them up. She's free to do it, and she has. But ultimately, outside of this room, I don't know who else is enjoying this. I don't know if anybody's enjoying this. And I can't play the game of how do I make everyone enjoy this show? Now, I'll be honest with you. I do look at, you know, how many views we have and how many times people have listened on certain social media and, you know, certain shows get more and certain shows get less. And I've kind of gotten the feeling of, okay, what kind of show people kind of gravitate towards and what type of guests and blah, 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 blah. But fundamentally, I can't do it and try to produce a show that everybody likes.
Right.
Because if I were to produce a show that everybody likes, guy in central Pennsylvania who wants me to insult certain ethnicities would have to like it. Guy, you know,
we don't want him.
Yeah, we don't want him. Guy who, you know, claims because he watched a right-wing website that, you know, Colin Kaepernick has changed religions when he hasn't. I don't want that guy to watch this damn show. And so it's tough because people sit and that's when it brings up with The Walking Dead. There's some guy.
Woo.
Yeah, there's some
really
guy.
Really went back around there. I didn't know if you were coming back.
But that's the, some guy is sitting in an executive position in LA or New York, seeing that the ratings are down 6 million people. And somewhere, someone has to kind of raise their hand like, well, is it the possibility because we have interracial relationships? And they're all just sitting there going, oh, we really? We have to give a damn about that? Like, but that's,
I mean,
the 11 game.
11 million viewers, I feel like, is enough.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's a good enough people. I mean, you can make a nice living.
Yeah.
But there's some executive out there, and this is why, you know, being in this business can sometimes suck, is you sit there, some executive is sitting there going up to him and going, well, with 17 million, our ad rates would go to this, and everybody else could get paid that, and that means this. And so you go, well, maybe we avoid the interracial relationships, and, you know, maybe we don't do as gory a storyline, and blah, blah, blah. And so eventually what happens is you have shows that are vanilla mush.
Vanilla.
Vanilla mush.
Vanilla?
Yeah, just...
Vanilla.
What? Are you...
You're saying vanilla.
Yeah.
I say vanilla.
Oh. So we stopped the, entire show to correct my...
Yes.
Did I say it incorrectly?
No, I guess not. It's just how you say it. I just wanted to tell you.
Okay. So just so you understand, anybody listening... I want both people. Now, I do want more people who say vanilla, and how do you say it?
Vanilla.
Okay. Either way, you can listen to this show. We both have camps. So if you want, however you say vanilla, however you say tomato, do you say tomato?
Yeah, everyone says tomato. No one says anything else besides tomato.
I've met some tomato people.
No, you haven't.
I've met
That's
some tomato
true.
People. I've met some tomato people. I want both tomato and tomato people to listen to me. That's one group that I will.
I don't want the tomato people.
You hate the tomato people.
Yeah, they can look away.
They can look away. They also, I believe, just converted to Islam. You don't like them for that.
Wow.
But again, that's the thing about this, that, you know, when you do broadcast, how do you please everybody? And so my answer is don't.
We don't.
We don't. Next off, we're going to take a little bit of a break.
Oh.
When we come back, we are going to discuss how... A foolproof way.
A foolproof.
A foolproof. Or proof. I want proof and proof. Way to win at social media. I'll give you an example, and you will be eternally grateful that I gave it to you. It's the Mike Sasson Show on the River's Edge. We'll be right back.
Oh, the holidays. I'm so sick of downtown and all of the traffic and the hustle and bustle. Can't find a parking space. It's awful.
Well, did you hear about the Millville Small Town Holiday Celebration?
Oh, I did. You mean the second annual Yuletide Tour?
Yeah, skip the mall. Shop small.
I love to shop and explore the 25 stops on this year's tour.
Wow, I love Millville businesses. This is awesome. 25 shops? That's great. But what am I going to do with the kids? The kids are going to get bored of shopping all day.
I hear they're having a Christmas carnival at the Millville Community Center from 1 to 3 with Santa.
And Santa is coming to town at 6 o'clock to light the tree.
So what do I do in between with the kids?
Well, there will be horse-drawn sleigh rides for the family from 1:30 to 3 with live music and entertainment throughout the day.
Oh, that's great. The kids will be worn out.
We'll drop the kids off with the sitter and come relax and enjoy Millville's pub scene. We'll have drink specials and live music.
So come on out Saturday, December 3rd, 10 to 10, and explore all of the great businesses Millville has to offer. You can follow us on Facebook and Twitter for more information at BAM15209.
Shop local.
The Thanks so much for hanging out at the River's Edge Radio. Right here, you got Jeremy Kaywood hanging with Brian Crawford for this little promo. December 2nd at the Funhouse of Mr. Smalls is my CD release show. You should come and check that out. December 2nd at the Funhouse of Mr. Smalls. We have Andre Costello, Jeremy Colbert, Tori Shinneman for some spoken words, some classical violin playings and stylings from Johanna Chastik. Special appearances by Adam Levine and The Way of Life. It's going to be so awesome. You should come on down to the Funhouse at Mr. Smalls on December 2nd for my CD release show. Thanks, guys. Keep listening to River's Edge Radio.
I am a dog, and I must obey to be fed and throw the ball, and I will chase it till the end. I keep running and panting.
Stay clear of the streets, for God's sake! The timid and the fearful drivers are every bit as bad as the aggressive drivers. Nobody in Pittsburgh knows what a right-of-way is. I go down the road and I just sing this song, the gas is on the right. The gas is on the right. Hi-ho, the highway, yo! The gas is on the right.
Get educated with Brian Crawford live Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays at 10 a.m. here on the River's Edge.
It's headquartered in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. There's probably like zero people up there. I was on a cruise with a guy from Alberta, and he had like never been out of Alberta before in his life.
Yeah.
And he was like, he's like, you know when the oil freezes in your car? And I'm like, no. No. Hey, Money Bags, tune into Funny Money at 7 a.m. Thursdays.
Did you hear Tom? He said 7 a.m. Tune in.
Hi, I'm Mike Storr, host of The Awesome Cast, which you can hear right here on River's Edge Radio. We're talking tech, getting geeky every week with people from Pittsburgh in the industry. Go check us out, awesomecast.net, or listen to us right here on River's Edge Radio, Thursday mornings, 8 a.m. after Funny Money.
It's the Mike Sasson Show, back on the River's Edge. You can listen to us live again at www.riversedgepgh.com or on TuneIn Radio or on Facebook Live or after the fact on YouTube, on SoundCloud, on Google Play, or on iTunes. Big deal right now, obviously, with the election of Trump. I personally believe people are going to analyze his election for decades to come. And one thing they're going to bring up constantly is one of the things that he was able to do was overcome a gigantic deficit in terms of financial backing by using social media correctly. And one of the things that that I was thinking about along those same lines was there was a story last week about down in West Virginia. I don't know if you saw this, but there was a story where it was that this really mean teacher, there was a video of it, a really mean teacher had this kid who was autistic in the Thanksgiving play. And that's all we knew about it. And so this kid, everybody's supposed to get up to the microphone and say like Happy Thanksgiving, all this other kind of stuff, and that's how the story was presented. And the last kid was the kid with autism, and at the moment that he was going to say something, the teacher yanked the microphone out of the microphone stand. And the way it was portrayed is that this was just the most awful, just, oh my God, moment, what an evil teacher, and what an evil thing to do. Why can't and the mother wrote on this post that all the kid was going to say was gobble, gobble, and what an ununderstanding teacher, and she should be fired, and blah, blah, blah. And because of this teacher got just constant harassment and people online saying you're a terrible person and you're going to burn in hell and all this other kind of stuff. And I was one of those people like, oh, what a horrible teacher. We should, do something about this. Well, a couple days ago, another person came out and said, no, that's not what happened. Here's what actually happened.
Okay.
The kid who has autism did not go to any of the rehearsals for the play. Okay. The mother didn't take him. He just shows up the day of the play. Now, the teacher very easily said, hey, you didn't come to any rehearsals. You're not in the play. sit in the audience or go home, whatever. Some kids worked. You didn't. You can't be here.
Right.
Instead, she sat there and said, we'll have you sit on stage.
Yeah.
They created a part where, you know, they dress, you know, they put a little like paper mache turkey head on him or whatever, and he was going to be the Thanksgiving turkey. But they said to the kid and the mom, he won't have any lines. He's just going to sit on stage. He can be part of the play. But because he hasn't been part of rehearsals, I don't know what he's going to say. I don't know what he's going to do. So he's just going to stay on stage, and that will be his part of the play.
Yeah.
And so what actually happened is afterwards, the kid goes up to the microphone, and the teacher's just like, hey, wait a minute. I don't know what this kid's about to say.
Yeah.
I don't know if the kid's going to embarrass himself. I don't know if he's going to, you know, say expletives. I don't know what he's going to say. And that's why the teacher pulled the microphone.
Mm-hmm.
And it brought up this point of, if I hadn't saw the second story, I would still have the opinion that the teacher was a jerk. And it brought up to this point of, like, that first woman won the social media battle.
Yes.
Because she followed the Trump-like rules of how you win in social media. So I have come up with these rules that you can live by so that you understand if you ever get into that situation to where you want your truth to get out there, how you win at social media. So these are Mike Sasson's how to win at social media. Rule one. Okay.
Yeah.
Tell your side, even if it's a lie, and never stop. Just keep saying it. Just keep throwing it out there. Just keep retweeting it. Don't stop. Be a machine, you know, and have people that are on your side. Keep retweeting it. Doesn't matter if it's a complete and utter lie. Second off, again, keep repeating the lie. Just keep.
So number two is the same as number one?
But it's reinforcing it.
Okay.
Just keep doing it. Okay?
Is number three keep doing it?
No. Number three is value followers among anything else. If you, your only goal in life should be to get as many followers as humanly possible, because followers equal power. Now, however you do that, you know, by, again, printing lies about people, about, you know, you want to be Instagram famous, obviously posting a picture of a wonderful woman's butt. That seems to be the way to do it. However you want to do it, just get followers. It doesn't matter how you do it, just do it. Okay? Because followers equal power. One of the great quotes by Donald Trump recently says, how much did he love Twitter? He goes, having Twitter is like owning the New York Times and not having any of the losses. That's how he viewed Twitter. It was like, hey, this is my own personal newspaper that I can produce anything I want. I can say anything I want. And again, because he follows rule one and rule two, which is just repeat, repeat, repeat. Does not matter if there's a lie, go from there. Number four is, if by happenstance someone comes out with the truth or you contradict yourself, still don't stop repeating what you initially did. It's just like when, again, the Donald Trump rule, when he sat there and in the debate, he sat there and said, and when Hillary Clinton said, you said that global warming was a hoax provoked by the Chinese. He said, no, I didn't. And then they retweeted when he actually did say it. Did he ever say, oh, I apologize?
Right.
No, he didn't. And by the way, that's rule five. Never apologize.
That's a good rule for life.
Ever apologize. Doesn't matter if you're proven beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're wrong. If I'm this woman from West Virginia, you've won the social media battle. Everybody thinks that this teacher is an awful person. It doesn't matter that you were wrong. It doesn't matter that you might be hurting a professional teacher's future. That there's actually been people that have said they want to physically harm this woman. It doesn't matter. You've won. Just keep hammering. Don't have a conscience. You've won the battle. Just keep going.
This is very scary.
It's a scary world, social media. It's a scary, scary world. That's one of the things that they found out after the election, that nearly a third of the quote-unquote news sites that you saw on Facebook, like you sat there and went like, Hillary Clinton actually has three heads, or Donald Trump you know, blood is actually pure evil. No, a third of
that's not true.
It's not true.
Shit.
But
I'm one of those people that believes the fake news sites.
Yes, yeah. But there are people who sit there and again clickbait, where you sit there and be like, unbelievable, you know, revelations about Barack Obama's past, and someone go, oh, okay, boom, and it turns out to be like, you know, dick pics or dick pills or something with dicks. But I mean, like,
that sounds wonderful. That sounds like, where are those news sites? I never click on those.
You're getting the wrong sites. Yeah. But again, that's it's. When I saw this, that was how I viewed that. That's how you win at social media. Now, on the flip side, you have to sometimes understand you can lose at social media. And there was an epidemic of incorrectly sent nudity over the holiday weekend.
Ooh.
So there was
my favorite. I don't like correctly sent nudity.
Yeah, these are the three stories, and I want you to rank these in terms of
how bad they are.
How bad they are.
Okay.
Okay. First
one.
I'm
so excited.
Okay. So guy goes to, you know, is getting ready to go to Thanksgiving dinner, and, you know, just for a playful thing, sends his girlfriend a dick pic.
Right.
Turns
what
out.
What you naturally do before Thanksgiving dinner.
Yes. But he accidentally sent it to his sister right before. So let's say, for instance,
she lost her appetite.
Yeah. Let's say, for instance, your sister's boyfriend, right before Thanksgiving dinner, accidentally sent it to you. How
Wait,
would you
I thought
react?
He sent it to his sister.
No, his girlfriend's sister.
Okay, that's not as bad.
That's not as
if
bad.
He sent it to his own sister. That would be like, oh.
Yeah,
you know, I don't want to see, you know, my brother's.
But how would you? But how would you react if you got your by accident? And he claims by accident, your sister's boyfriend's dick pic. Would you be like, would you bring it up? Would you be like, huh? What is?
I'd bring it up with him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd tell my sister. Maybe okay. I don't know. It depends.
You'd get liquored up and probably tell her.
Yes. Exactly.
After a bottle of wine.
That's like, when it all comes out.
Look at this. And then you'd go through your
I
own.
Really don't think it would be that big of a deal, though.
Okay, so you're ranking.
Like, okay, that was clearly a mistake. Obviously, he did not mean to send it to me.
But okay, here's my thing.
Or we'll just pretend it was
a
mistake.
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing. Because sometimes the guy could be like, it was a mistake, but what'd you think? All right, so we're saying that
I might just compliment my sister and be like, good job, you
but
picked well.
But what if it wasn't good? What if you're just like, ah, that's sad.
Then I'd be sad for my sister, maybe try and find her a new mate.
Yeah, you'd be like, and you would just show other dick pics. You'd be like, look at this guy.
Yeah.
There you go. I know what that guy's packing.
Well, that one's not that bad.
Okay. All right, this one's, I personally think this one's bad. All right, so this was written by a woman who was going to Thanksgiving dinner with her new fiance.
Okay.
And her new fiance's dad, who she had never met, comes to Thanksgiving dinner. They kind of shake hands. They kind of, hey, whatever. They have Thanksgiving dinner. So then that night, she gets a text from the dad. And she's just like, okay, you know, that's nice of him. Probably just said, hey, great meeting you, whatever. No, it was her fiance's dad sending a dick pic with the caption, because she has red hair. You like this red? See,
but like that was
deliberate,
totally meant for her. That's
yes.
Weird.
See, to me, that's his mistake, because you could always play off the, oh, it was a mistake. I meant to send it to somebody else.
Yeah, don't put any kind of caption.
Yeah, but by the way, are you digging it?
That's weird. I don't think I'd feel comfortable being around that man ever again in my life.
Would you tell your fiance?
I don't know.
You'd have to.
I might have a conversation with
you'd have
his
to
father
be,
first.
I would
be like,
I,
what's up with this dude?
Well,
what are
I,
you
I,
doing?
Well, you'd pretty much know what's up with it.
Right.
You understand
but
what
like,
he's doing.
What are you doing? Why?
There's no explanation.
Stop this.
Yeah, I think you could. I think again, you'd have to say stop it. But to me, I would have to. You'd have to go up to your fiance
at least
and be
give
like,
him,
this is why I don't feel comfortable around your father.
Or maybe give the father the benefit of the doubt at first. And go up to him and be like, hey, listen, was this really meant for me? Because it surely seems like it was.
Well, again, he said in the picture, you know, you like this.
Well, maybe he also was talking to some other redheaded person at the same time. Or maybe he was talking to a person named Red.
Yeah, like from Shawshank Redemption. Yes, he was talking to Morgan Freeman from Shawshank Redemption. Going, do you like my naked genitals? Okay, third story.
What if she then dumped her fiance for her fiance's dad?
How crazy
would that be?
Okay, now you're getting into the psychology of the nudity pic, and to me, that's what has to go through your brain. Going, you know what? Okay. She likes the bull. You know, she likes the calf. Maybe she'll like the bull. Because I'm just, you know, I'm him, only with more experience and more money.
Right.
This is, hey, you think you're in coach right now. This is first class. I think that's how he has to think. He has to think, okay, you got the, you know, this is the man. Okay, you got the boy. Come sit at the man's table. You're at the kiddie table. Sit at the grown-ups table. I could start doing those, those all day. And I'd have to stop.
Next story.
Okay, this is from a female.
Okay.
All right. So, woman, 46 years old, dating 46, 47-year-old man with children. They're having a rocky relationship. They're about to break up.
Okay.
Husband or the boyfriend says to the girlfriend, if you break up with me and we have a bad relationship, I have tons of videos of you and tons of pictures of you naked. I'm going to share them with your family. I'm going to share them with your coworkers, and you're going to be humiliated. So you better not mess with me. So she gets the bright idea of, aha, I'm going to do a preemptive strike. I'm going to send a nude photo of me to the boyfriend's 17-year-old son. So she sends a nude photo, unsolicited, to the 17-year-old son of her boyfriend. Now here's the problem. The 17-year-old kid went up to the dad and said, what's up with this? And the dad, again already proving that he plays dirty, called the cops.
Wow.
And now she has been arrested. By the way, that's the response you wanted for the first two. But see, comedy, it's out of every orifice of my body. Now she is essentially has to be put on a she forever will be a sex offender.
Poop on him.
You're blaming him?
Blaming him. First of all, he was a dick in the first place. Granted, that's probably not the way that you should solve it by doing that. Personally, if it was me, I would break into his house, steal all of his electronic things, delete all of the pictures forever for good, give them back, and then boom, you're done. That's it.
So
nothing can happen.
So you'd go all like CIA ninja stuff, and you'd have to.
Or I'd be like, go ahead, send them to my family. Like, my family has seen me barely clothed. Like, really, is it that bad? And unless they're like really, really suggestive photos.
Yeah,
I'm not quite sure.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. I go,
send,
I love you,
nude
pause,
pictures, but not ever, but not too dirty.
See,
that's the thing.
Now you're getting into the point. You're like, you know what? I wouldn't mind if my
But that's the thing. You just can't make them too dirty. Just in case.
You need creative control.
Be like, when you're sending them, be like, if my mother ever saw this, would she be disappointed at me? That's how you have to think about nude photos.
That's how all right, so Alex, okay, on the fly, come up with your rules for nude photos. Number one.
That is my main rule.
That's your main rule, which is when you send it, make sure that if anybody does see this, that's my rule for emails. Like with work emails, because everybody always gets in trouble with work emails where they send like a joke or something. I always say it is, okay, when you send this email or when you send this text, make sure that if anybody ever reads this, that you'll have no problems. Which honestly is my point in social media too. Which I don't get how people go on social media and like say like, I hate Barack Obama, he's a stupid moron. And then when someone prints it and retweets it, then he's like, I don't understand why everybody's mad at me. And I'm like, you have to understand, anytime you put anything and press send, it's now part of the internet. It's not part of the ether. Yeah, it's out there. And so once you press send, it's out of your hands. You got to go do that. And it's the same thing with nude photos. So you're saying is make sure that any of your nude photos, you're saying you're tastefully done. Don't go hustler. Go old school Playboy.
Yeah. Some tasteful black and white nudes. Everyone appreciates this.
Everyone appreciates tasteful black and white. Hire a nice fashion photographer.
Yeah. And then just keep that stack of photos, you know, and then send them to whoever. You just recycle them with people. You don't ever take new ones.
That reminds me of like on Entourage where they had Johnny Drama and he used the same headshot from like when he was 19 years old to when he was like 45.
Yeah, it's especially good for when you get old. If you'd only have one set of nude photos that you have, then.
So you'd said, so your point is you take your nude photos when you were 23. And then when you're 43 and you're out in the
because
prowl.
Because I'm still apparently sending nude photos when I'm 43.
Yeah, why not? You might send them as Christmas gifts. By that time, it's just like, you know.
No one cares.
No one cares. It's just like, hey, happy, Merry Christmas from Alex. Like, oh, Alex sent me another nude photo.
That's very tasteful.
Merry Christmas. By the time you're in 20 years, by that time, I think everyone will be just like so.
Or everyone will just be like, aw, look at Alex when she was younger.
Yeah, I like that. Aw. Look how cute she was.
She was so mature taking, you know, these nice, tasteful black and white nudes.
That's how it works. See, this is what this show's about. It's about learning. And that's why you're going to learn from Alex every week. And this should be especially good because we've already mentioned that Alex spent most of the weekend drunk. This weekend, it's a special post-Thanksgiving Alex Bar Thoughts with Alex. Bar Thoughts and Experience with Alex. I finally got the name of the segment right. It's Bar Thoughts and Experience with Alex. Play UB40. You know you got me liking this song now, right?
Before, are you saying that you didn't like it before?
There was a point where if that was on the radio and I'd be like, oh, red, red wine, boom, change. Now I'm kind of like, oh, that's kind of got a good beat.
Ew.
You were more disgusted by that than the dick pic stories.
Yeah.
Okay.
I love dick pic stories.
All right. Okay, so again, Alex gets drunk, writes down what she's thinking, and it's Bar Thoughts and Experiences with Alex.
So, we said this would be somewhat Thanksgiving-themed.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, my thought on Thanksgiving, while having a glass of wine in one hand and a turkey leg in the other, is that sometimes our family conversations at holidays can sometimes get very dark or heated, and I don't like that. I don't appreciate that. So I came up with a list of conversation topics that you can talk about with your family that won't get heated.
Okay.
Most likely won't make anyone upset or mad.
Okay. But now you're getting into the point of like, it's like when you went up earlier in the show where I said, oh, you don't have to try to make everybody happy. You should just try to have a show that you find good. You're saying, but on holidays, you should try to kind of edit
it's
yourself.
It's a holiday.
Okay, it's a holiday. Okay.
You don't have to edit yourself. Just talk about good things.
Okay, go
ahead.
Like
these things.
All right.
What presents you want for Christmas or what presents you already got, especially if there are kids around, ask them what presents they got and then play with those awesome toys.
Okay.
Books, TV shows, or movies that you like.
Mm-hmm.
Which holiday meal is your favorite and why? We had that discussion. It's always a good discussion.
Mm-hmm.
Unless people like get really upset about food. Which, poop on them. Puppies. You can always talk about puppies, and that's a good conversation. Most people won't get upset about puppies. Or any kind of cute, insanely cute animal like puppies. And if anyone doesn't like puppies or insanely cute animals, then you could just kick them out of your house right there. Because they're horrible people. Awesome restaurants around you. Adele. Everyone likes Adele.
Everyone likes Adele.
I've never heard anyone be like, ugh. I hate Adele. She is the worst. Like everyone's like, oh, you know, I don't really listen to her music that much, but I don't think it's terrible.
When Hello first came out, yeah, everyone listened to that song.
Exactly.
I listened to that song.
Yeah, and then everyone got sick of that song.
Yeah, because they played it 32 times an hour.
Ask relatives what you were like as a child unless you sucked as a child. Good dad jokes, because dad jokes are always a hit. Everyone loves dad jokes.
Mm-hmm.
Your job, unless you work at a funeral home or your job just sucks in general. Traveling. That's always a good one.
Okay.
Your most embarrassing moment.
Okay.
Not someone else's most embarrassing moment, because you don't want to upset them. And only tell your most embarrassing moment if you are at that point where you can laugh with everyone else.
I think, well, yours is broadcast every Tuesday from 10 to 11:30.
My most embarrassing moment?
Yeah. But
that's true. I don't have very many embarrassing moments because I'm me.
Yes. Because you're just
perfect.
Yeah, you're just this perfect angelic creature that sends nude photos. But now, here's my thing listening to all those. I could totally imagine at my household us getting into arguments about each and every single one
of those.
Even
puppies?
Things. Okay, I thought about puppies. Here's how the conversation with puppies would go at the Sasson household. Man, I like puppies. Really? When you had a dog, you didn't take care of it. I always had to take care of it. What are you talking about? I always had to take care of it. No, I had to wake up at 5:30 in the morning because your dog would...
See, you approach it in a different way. Aren't puppies cute?
Yeah, yes. They're cute until they grow up, and then they crap all over the house. Okay, so...
What about cures for the hangover that you have?
Why are you drinking so much? You have a problem. No, I don't. Yes, you do. You should stop drinking. You should stop being a jerk. I hate you.
How about Tom Hanks?
Tom Hanks. Forrest Gump. Let's watch Forrest Gump. I don't want to watch Forrest Gump again. Why? It's a very good movie. No, it's not. I've seen it 150 times.
The love that you have for your family.
I love you. Really? That's great. Yeah, that'd be a good one.
Yeah, there you go. That's what you talk about the whole holiday.
But then eventually everyone just kind of... When you do say that, you're just like, hey, I love you. And then my family be like, what's your angle? What are you trying to do? You need money? What's going on?
You have to genuinely say it.
I know.
I'm very thankful that you're here today.
I know. We do say it, but then eventually, like in my household, everyone just goes, what's your deal,
I don't
want
to come
Grandma?
To your household for holidays.
No one does. That's why people stayed in their own house. But like...
Because if I talked about these topics with my family...
What topic?
I can't think of any that would actually cause debate.
Which topics did you talk about over the weekend that actually caused debate?
Not so much debate. I mean, we had to tell people, certain people in our family, hey, don't talk about politics because politics never make people happy. Even if no one agrees on everything.
Okay.
So that's just don't.
So you made a rule that said, okay, in this household for the next day.
I mean, obviously I'm pretty sure someone brought it up, but like no one touched on it, you know?
Okay.
So like, just don't elaborate on it.
Don't elaborate. But did someone do that?
No.
Okay. So you did not have any arguments over the Thanksgiving holiday?
Actually, no. Well, I mean, we didn't have any, we don't have like heated arguments. It's just kind of those arguments where other people are like, they're just sitting there stewing, or people walk out of the room like me.
And then go get another bottle of wine.
I leave discussions usually if I'm not happy about them. I don't say, because I don't have very many opinions, but if people are talking about things I don't really want to hear, then I just leave.
See, I love a good argument.
I don't.
I love it.
It's the combative
nature. It's the combative nature. My family's a group of, so we got football coaches. We got comedians. We got lawyers. So you're talking about, you get lawyers and comedians in the same room. Again, arguments are going to happen. Now, I will say this. 99 times out of 100, after the argument's over, there is no resent. We're pretty good at that.
That's good.
Now, that one time you do kind of cross over, you just can't say something that you can't take back. It's very similar to social media. Once it's out there, it's out there. You just have to make sure you don't take that one step beyond where you sit there and say, yeah, that's why you've never been married. And then
I feel like my family is a family where we'll get into like some type of argument and then someone will hold something in for like 15 years. They don't say anything about it then. They don't say anything about it for 15 years. And then all of a sudden something just blows up. You know, and then someone says that thing that they're angry about for 15 years, that they've been stewing about for 15 years, and that's like, shit.
Bill Parcells, who's a football coach who was very successful, one of his rules was don't be afraid of conflict.
I'm afraid of conflict.
Well,
I'm not afraid of conflict, I just don't prefer it.
Well, his point was conflict kind of gets all of it out of the way. And so instead of something stewing for 6 months or a year and it becoming a gigantic thing, you just hit it straight on and say, you know, hey, this is what I think. And you have the 5 or 10 minute discussion. And after that 5, 10, it's like taking a, you know, a giant poop. It's just done. It's out. You're good. It's over.
Or you just be like me and you don't give a shit about whatever that person is talking about. And then like 3 seconds later, you just forget about the whole conversation. And then you're not mad ever.
Well, okay, your method is just to have this kind of attitude of just like nothing is that important, don't worry about it, everything. But what happens if it's something that is not going away? It's something that is a constant irritable thing in your life and you're never dealing with it.
I don't know, I don't have those things.
You don't have those things?
Nope.
Well, someday you might. Someday you might, and that's when you have to kind of sit there and say, you know what, I'm not
very
a big...
nicely, calmly talk about it, and then forget and leave.
If there's one thing that I have done more recently, is I have gotten, especially around holidays. You know, I've been to now multiple weddings over the past year. You know, you go to the people's houses, all the kind of good stuff. I've become very much just like whatever you need me to do. You know, I'm just gonna sit in this chair. If you need me to cut onions, I'll go cut onions. If you need me to just sit here, if the kids need someone to play with, I'll play with the kids. If you need me to ignore the fact that the kids are destroying the house, I will ignore that the kids are destroying the house. That's my toughest thing in holidays now.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, my nieces, Carly and Mia, 5 and 2 years old, just are a tidal wave of destruction. And my natural instinct is to sit there and go sit down and pay attention and blah, blah, blah. Now, so it's every one of my inclinations just like, okay, you're going to break that lamp. You're going to break that lamp. You're going to break that lamp. And you're just like, don't break the lamp. Don't break the lamp. And then like they break the lamp and I'm just like, I knew you were going to break the lamp.
This is why alcohol helps.
It's again.
Because then you don't care. Go ahead, break that lamp. I don't care. I have a glass of wine. I'm fine.
Again, alcohol does help that. But mine is just, you know, my natural alcohol of just like, you know what, if their two parents aren't concerned about it, as long as they're not going to hurt themselves, as long as they're not going to, you know, again, it's all about hurt. Because an average 5 or 2 year old does something at least once an hour that threatens their life. They do something that if they eventually got through what they were doing, would end up with their own demise.
Right.
And so all you're doing as the adult is trying to avoid that one time an hour where that kid could actually hurt themselves. And other than that, you're just kind of just like, don't break anything that would be super expensive to fix. And that's how you walk into someone's house who has like multiple kids and it looks like a frat house mixed with a crack house if a bunch of 9-year-olds were smoking crack. That's what that was in my house. Anyone always sits there and says, like, what was your house like with 8 kids? It looked like a frat house if a bunch of 9-year-olds were going to college. That's what it looked
like. It makes sense.
You'd walk in and there'd just be, like, you know, stains on the carpet that you would have no idea what this was at one point. Like, was this cola? Was this jelly? Was this, it just there.
Blood.
It's just, yeah, it was one of the kids' blood, you know, couches that just, you know, were just, you know, again, a frat house would say, we should burn this the next time the team wins a game, would be our, like, main couch.
Yes.
And, like, and essentially, as long as the TV worked, as long as, you know, the stove and microwave worked, my parents were just like, you know what, I'm not into this fight, whatever, just do what you gotta do. When you have 8 kids, essentially your parents become the CEO. They don't like hands-on direct. Like that was me and my sister Meg's job. We were kind of like in charge of making sure that our younger brothers and sisters didn't die.
Right.
That was the directive. Like, you know, one of the jokes that it's a family kind of joke is one time I was after a Steeler game, I was walking and because I'm a super cool athlete, I was really fast getting back to the car, dodging through everything like that.
Right.
Because that's important when you're 11 years old. It's like, look how fast I am. And I'm so much faster and I'm going to get to the car first. And my sister Meg, who was not the super cool athlete, was kind of falling behind. And so she started to like cry, wait up. And to this day, my sister still says that my dad grabbed me, looks at me, and he goes, "Never lose your sister." And so to this day, my sister will be in a mall, will be, you know, in the house cooking, whatever. And my sister Meg will be like, "Michael, remember, never lose your sister." So it was always my responsibility to make sure that Meg was within eyesight. So that was how I did it. So very good bar thoughts and experience. Very good in trying to come up with things that will not cause arguments.
Except in the Sasson household. It's,
well, again, "Hey, I love you." "What do you mean you love me?" All right. Next up, something that will cause a debate. It's the top five. Hey, did you see this video yet? No, you didn't. Of course you didn't. Today. I really like this song. It's so... One thing I figured
out... That's about how much I like of that song.
Yeah. One thing I figured out about... The reason why I wanted you to watch the videos. One thing I've noticed about 80s videos as opposed to videos up until even today. One thing that was universal, especially amongst rock bands of the 80s, is they all wanted to give the impression that they were the biggest thing in the world.
Right.
Like, they wanted you to when you watched a Van Halen, a Bon Jovi, a Guns N' Roses, a Europe, you know, video, the director really wanted to make sure you understood that this band was a big deal.
Yeah.
Like, the video you would see right there, that was their first video. They were obviously over in Europe. And the whole point was, it was at a big TV studio. And they were showing it, and there was a big crowd. And you get the da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da. And there's like, "Take two, camera three." And so if you're a kid back in, you know, Pittsburgh, and you're like, "Wow, this must be the biggest
TV.
Band. This must be the biggest band in the world." They're already like, and then it's such the funniest, like, 80s thing that I know would never fly today. For some reason, they take the band on the roof of an arena,
right?
Okay? And there's a helicopter going around there, and there's a crowd around the arena, and the band is waving, and on top of the arena, they painted Europe Tour 1986. So they painted the top of the arena. So that's the difference. If someone says, what is the difference between, you know, music pre-Nirvana and post-Nirvana? Post-Nirvana, Nirvana was just like, "We're just a bunch of regular guys wearing flannel and sweaters, and we're just playing our instruments." Whereas before, like, they wanted, every band wanted, "No, we're rich. We make the biggest music. We make the most money. We make everything like that." That was the biggest difference. And right. You hear it in that song. You know, it's just supposed to sound like this is the beginning of the greatest concert in the world.
Maybe we should just watch it together sometime. Like,
we should.
We'll watch it on the show.
We should.
We'll have a live commentary of it.
The problem is we can't actually show the video, I don't think.
Yeah, we can show it.
Oh, okay, fine. We'll pay him. All right, so what I was thinking of is this weekend, had a lot of thought, a lot of thinking about where I am in my life, which is pretty much every weekend. I do that constantly. It doesn't lead me. It leads to internal arguments. But one of the things that I've found whenever you talk to people is if they're not doing what they want to do, they have ready-made excuses. And there's a top five ones that I've always heard. And these are the top five excuses that people have given me or I've heard, and I'm going to debunk each one of them.
Okay.
Okay. Number five. Parents, teachers, coaches never believed in me. Here's the thing. I was a coach at one point. Coaches want to win. Teachers want to teach kids that are smart. And your parents, again, had their own problems. If you were truly any good at whatever you wanted to do, they would have helped you out.
Right.
Okay. If you sit there and say, "Well, I could," this always happens with, like, you know, I always hear this because I will say, "Hey, I played college football." They go, "Oh, yeah, I would have played college football too, but my coach never sent out the film." You want to know why? Because the film would have sucked. Yeah. Yeah. That's why your coach never sent it out. That's why your coach didn't talk to the coach at Penn State and said, "Hey, you should pick this kid."
Right.
Because the coach at Penn State would have looked at it and went, "This, you're an idiot.
You're stupid.
Yeah, you're stupid." Okay. So number five, again, if your parents, teachers, coaches, the reason why they didn't believe in you is because there was nothing to believe in. Number four, everything is rigged against me. That's why, you know, don't you understand that, you know, the only people that get to, you know, be on TV or the only people that get this or that or the other thing is because of politics and because of all this other kind of stuff. Does that happen sometimes? Sure. But you know what? Then just get better. Keep working at it. Just keep getting better. If you're not, anytime I don't get a gig, I just say to myself, well, I guess I got to get better.
Right.
Guess I got to go to more mics. Guess I got to write better material. Just keep going. Not ready yet. And then just kind of go from there. Number three, political correctness has just made it that you have to be blank. And that's how you become successful. This happens a lot in entertainment. Because people will sit there and say, you know, I'm just a middle-aged white guy. And, you know, they're all looking for this. Or they're all looking for gay guys. Or they're looking for straight this. Or women. Or, you know, this. And you go, you look on TV and go, I see plenty of middle-aged white guys, you know, being successful on television.
Right.
It's not like there's no more of them. Now...
That would be good.
Yeah.
That would be kind of cool.
Alex would actually like that. Alex, that's her goal.
There's only young, very attractive males on TV.
Well, I think there's plenty of those people. But at the end of the day, it's like when you pick a movie, when someone's casting a movie. If someone's looking for, you know, if someone's saying, okay, we're going to do the life story of Martin Luther King, there's a good chance that Leonardo DiCaprio is not getting that role.
Right.
Yeah. It's the same thing. If someone is putting together a comedy show and they're like, you know what? We've got two or three middle-aged white guys. Let's change it up a little bit. Let's, you know, because here's the other thing is you need a pattern break. If it's all just the same type of person, and it's the same thing as if it's all the same of anything, it's very difficult for that show to be successful. You've got to throw somebody else in there that kind of livens it up and changes it and everything like that. So again, if you feel you're not being chosen because you're not part of the preferred group at this point, again, work harder. Just go back and work on your stuff. Number two, I'm just unlucky. Other people are more lucky than me. One of the things, again, this comes back to when I say that I play college football. Someone will come up to me like, yeah, I was looking at Notre Dame, Pitt, Penn State. Then I hurt my ankle, so I never got to play. And here's the reality of it. Okay, if Pitt, Penn State, and Notre Dame are looking at you as a football player and you hurt your ankle, unless you ripped off your ankle and now you no longer have a foot, some school is going to pick you up.
Right.
Like, for instance, when I played at Connecticut, we had a tailback. His senior year, he broke his leg.
Mm-hmm.
Before the broken leg, Penn State was looking at him.
Yeah.
Then he broke his leg.
Yes.
So Connecticut took him.
There you go.
That's how it works. If you were looking at Penn State, you broke your leg, you're looking at Connecticut.
Yeah.
If, let's say, for instance, you broke your leg and Connecticut was looking at you and now Connecticut doesn't look at you, now Delaware looks at you. Now Villanova looks at you. Or even IUP or Slippery Rock looks at you. And a lot of times that's how, you know, you ever see a pro football player. Like, how did a pro football player come from Bloomsburg?
Yeah.
Maybe he was injured in high school.
Yeah.
But he gets to go somewhere.
Yeah.
He doesn't, it's not like, okay, football's over. Again, unless literally your leg, you know, blew off. Like, you're now an amputee. That's the only way, like, yeah, then you're not playing football. But if you were looking at, like, I've heard so many people, the coach from USC was in here looking. That's like, there's a movie called All the Right Moves.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about high school football in Western Pennsylvania. And in the story, like, this guy sits there and he's going to Southern Cal. He's in a town in Western Pennsylvania. He's a linebacker, and he's committed to Southern Cal, which if you're a kid in Western Pennsylvania and the University of Southern California wants you as a linebacker, you're probably one of the five best linebackers in the country.
Yeah.
Well, he gets his girlfriend pregnant.
Ugh.
And so he goes, I can't leave town. I can't, you know. And I'm just sitting there going, then go to Pitt.
Right.
Go to Slippery Rock. Go to Penn State. You don't have to go all the way across the country. If you're good enough to go to USC from a small town in Western Pennsylvania, there are plenty of schools in Western Pennsylvania though where you can stay near your girlfriend who has a kid and still play college football. It's not over.
Right.
You know, this is not, you know, that's again, I'm unlucky. No, you're not. You're just not. You weren't any good. And the number one reason I hear people all the time saying, I don't get what I want,
is, well, when I got my opportunity, everyone around me didn't know what they were doing. You know what? If you're good enough, yeah, sometimes you fall into a bad situation, but you know what? You would have gotten another opportunity. Yes, sometimes it's tough because people around you aren't kind of up to snuff. But again, maybe that's not the right situation. You move on. Again, that's the top five reasons that I have gotten why people say their life hasn't gone the way they wanted to. And I have debunked them all. Do you agree that I've debunked them all, Alex?
Yeah, I agree with you.
Okay. Again,
pretty much for all the same reason.
Yeah, which is essentially,
you're not good enough.
You're just not good enough. Just get better. All right.
Or do something else.
We're going to take a small little break. And when we come back, we're going to have news and notes. A very successful news and notes. Lots of weird people doing really stupid things. Trust me, you will enjoy it. It's the Mike Sasson Show. We will be right back.
Would you be interested in developing conscious choice? Would you be interested in creating reactions rather than waiting for one to come? Would you be interested in combining serendipity and synchronicity? Would you be interested in making 1 + 1 = 3? Would you be interested in finding out about full impact mindfulness? If so, I challenge you to join myself, Jim Ellermeyer, a cognitive behavioral health therapist, every Sunday morning at 7 a.m. on the River's Edge, where we will challenge you to allow us to help you help yourself to fully participate in your life. Let the adventure begin.
Hey, this is Matt Geica, your host of Geic's Got Game, 8 a.m. every Friday here on the River's Edge. I'll take a peek behind the sports media curtain, zoom out for the big picture, and as always, obsess over the details of the sports, teams, and players we love or love to hate. It's Geic's Got Game every Friday at 8 a.m. on the River's Edge.
It's the Mike Sasson Show, again live on the River's Edge at www.riversedgepgh.com or on TuneIn Radio or live on Facebook Live or after the fact on iTunes, SoundCloud, or Google Play. Again, it's news and notes from around the world. Play me some Ice Cube. Play me some Ice Cube, because today is a very good day. Okay, first story. Very near and dear to my heart, so I'm going to ask you perception-wise. Okay.
Okie dokie.
They did a survey of regular students compared to college athletes. Their drug use, cigarette, all that kind of stuff.
Awesome.
Who drinks more? College athletes or regular students?
Oh, you're asking me.
Yes.
Okay.
No, I'm asking the other three people in the room. Yes. Alex, who drinks more?
Regular.
Actually, in this survey, college athletes, 62.1 say college to drink pretty regularly. Only 52.2% of college students say they drink regularly. You're a recent college graduate. Is this a little bit undershooting?
Yeah, I feel like all college students drink regularly.
All right. That means that the college athletes were not smart enough to
What is the percentage of regular students to athletes?
52% to 62%.
No, I mean just like that's drinking wise or
yes.
Just in general?
That's drinking wise.
How many regular students, how many athletes?
Like how many
do you understand what I'm saying?
Like how many basically like
did they
the
do
survey?
Like 50-50?
They interviewed 2,000 athletes, 2,000 regular students.
Okay.
And then kind of went from there.
Okay.
All right. Cigarettes. Who smokes more?
Regular people.
Regular students. Absolutely. Only 5% of athletes do. 21% of regular students. So one out of every five college students, according to this, smoke cigarettes.
That's good. That's a lot less than I would think.
All right. Who smokes more weed? Students or athletes?
Students.
Actually, regular. Athletes got it again.
No.
10% of athletes claim they smoke marijuana. 7.5% of regular students say they smoke marijuana. Which, again, this is a survey. Someone might be saying this from the cops.
That's
they might be lying.
Yeah, that's true.
Cocaine.
Cocaine.
Who snorts more cocaine, regular students or athletes?
Athletes.
Both are at like 0.6%, 0.7%.
Really?
Yeah, cocaine, that's a pretty expensive drug. If you're
that's
a,
true, yeah.
If you're a college student and you're doing all that kind of stuff. All right.
Cocaine.
Now, which sport does the most drugs?
Baseball.
You're saying baseball. All right.
I don't know why that was like really quick as my answer.
Did you say?
I feel like that's offensive towards baseball players.
Well, at Point Park, you didn't really. I mean, they didn't have a football team.
Right.
So baseball is probably the basketball team's kind of like they're only like 13 of them. So you saw more baseball players. Because according to this, lacrosse.
Oh.
The lacrosse team does the most drugs. 93% of them say they drink regularly. 46% of them say they smoke marijuana regularly. 40% of them say they spit tobacco. And 25% say they smoke cigarettes. So again, lacrosse. Now, number two, ice hockey. 97% of hockey players say they drink regularly.
Okay, that makes sense.
Number three was baseball players.
Okay, that's kind of close.
Yeah. Here's the thing that got me. Football players were behind soccer players in terms of drug use.
Okay. Well, yeah, I don't know.
There you go. Okay, now in terms of female athletes, ice hockey, female ice hockey players say they do the most drugs. Next, female lacrosse, then crew and gymnastics. They're the most puritanical. And in men's sports, basketball players.
I would like to see this study done on college students based on majors. What major they have and what major does the most drugs and things like that.
Liberal arts majors by far do the most drugs. I would say ones that are intense, like engineering or, you know, mathematics or computer sciences. I got to say that they're probably no, we're straight edge.
Maybe. You don't know, though.
Yeah. I would say.
Some of the athlete things were surprising. I would like to see that study done, though. So if, you know, someone who is waste their time on these studies, I would like to see that one.
There you go. All right. Another story.
Who did that study, by the way?
I don't know. Okay. Another person.
So it was totally made up.
Maybe it was totally made up, but it was interesting. So I read it. All right. Next up. A wife and a husband decide they wanted to have an open relationship.
Okay.
All right. So the husband goes on Tinder and starts to try to pick up girls.
Okay.
He is wildly unsuccessful.
I wonder why.
So guess who came to the rescue to help him pick up women?
The person who knows him best.
The wife. They came. He wrote a story. This guy wrote a story essentially saying, I could not get anyone to hook up with me on Tinder until my wife literally took the phone from me and acted as me for like 2 days. And she went up to him and goes, you got 6 dates.
Yeah.
So again, you know.
I don't think that's weird.
You don't think that's weird?
I would do that for my husband if we were in an open relationship. Because you're the person who knows them best. And you also, you would put their best qualities out there. You know, like a person you don't normally put all of you're a little more humble than someone else would be about you. You know what I mean? So it works when someone else does it for you.
So have you ever done that for a guy friend? You go, grab me that and just be you for a couple and say, all right, there you go. Boom.
Yeah.
There you go.
And I tell them what pictures to put there.
There. All
puppies and mountains.
Puppies and mountains. A mountain of puppies. That's not good. Yeah. Don't do a mountain of puppies.
Oh my God.
All right. A plus size model. I thought this was interesting. Okay. A plus size model who was like this, you know, famous all over, like did, you know, fashion runway, all this kind of stuff, decided to lose weight. She lost like something in the neighborhood of about 200 pounds.
Wow.
Not good for her because guess what? All the people that are on the, you know, that you're fat shaming, blah, 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 blah. She got death threats. Death threats because she lost weight.
I'm so sorry that I am trying to live longer and be a healthy person.
No, you don't understand. All beauty is beautiful and you shouldn't be trying to become something.
If all beauty is beautiful, then why can't she be skinny?
No, you're losing. You were one of us and now you've changed everything. Yeah, I agree with you. This is stupid.
Poop on those people.
Poop on those people. Okay.
That's what we should have a segment called Poop on Those People.
Next week we will have one. Poop on those people.
I can't wait to get the theme music for that.
Message us and see. When after the show, we see the messages. So if you see this or you whatever, tag us. Say, okay, what would be the theme song for Poop on Those People? Okay? And it can't be like, you know, just the sound of flatulence because that was my idea.
Oh, mine was the sound of like turds plopping into a toilet.
Is there a song that way?
We could make one.
Okay. If anybody out there knows how, you know, we have several musicians that are friends of us at the River's Edge. We can make a song.
Maybe like a little bit of guitar music behind turds plopping.
Again, the genius just emanates from this room, or maybe that's gas. Okay, another group of people that need to be pooped on is people at CVS who did this. Two black gentlemen walk into a CVS. Now you say, Mike, why are you identifying them as black gentlemen? Because it's key to the story. Yeah, it sounds like a racist joke that your uncle would say.
Yes.
But no, this is completely true. Real. So the two black gentlemen come in. It's a 24-hour CVS. They wanted cheese. They just had a hankering for cheese like any person would late at night. They say, hey, the CVS is open. Let's go find cheese.
Cheese.
All right. So they walk around the store. They can't find anybody who works there. Eventually, another person comes in saying, hey, I need toothache medication. Have you seen anybody? And they go, no, I haven't seen it. So they literally walk around the store for about 20 minutes thinking, like, did the zombie apocalypse happen? Where the heck is everybody? All of a sudden, police show up. They say, hey, we don't have anybody here. And the cops are like, oh, that's strange, whatever. It turns out that the people who are working at the CVS see the two black gentlemen walking into the CVS and run into the back room and lock themselves in and call the police.
Oh my God.
All they wanted was some cheese.
They just wanted some cheese, people.
And then the thing was about it was...
Where did this happen?
I believe it happened, I'm guessing, Virginia.
I don't know. Okay.
I didn't read the rest of the story. But here's... The sad part about it is the police eventually talked to the people and they went up to the two African-American gentlemen and they said, you have to leave or you'll be charged with vagrancy.
Wait, so they had to leave?
Yeah, with no cheese.
Wow. How rude is that?
Terrible.
Yeah, definitely poop on those people.
Poop. Next,
poop all over them.
Next week. That could be, if this was next week, we would be pooping all over those people. But Alex... we'll poop on them this week.
All of those people should have been fired.
Okay, absolutely. Well, according to CVS, they are receiving counseling. All right. Hopefully someday I will be...
Also, the guys who walked into the store should get like a giant gift certificate.
Kraft,
or at least an apology.
Kraft should send them a bunch of cheese.
Yeah.
They should be... We should have a cheese...
A better cheese brand than that.
Okay, whatever. A great cheese brand should... The good people at Kraft.
It's a cheese basket.
Yeah. By the way, if Kraft wants to sponsor the show, I'm a big fan of the Kraft cheese.
I like Kraft. It's just there are better.
Well, here's the thing. They could be watching because Kraft and Heinz are now the same company. So, you know, yeah, great job losing us that big lucrative cheese money, Alex. All right. Next up. That's all we're about. We're big lucrative cheese money. All right. Here's something that scares the heck out of me. I hope to someday be insanely rich. I hope someday that I could become a rich entertainer like Phil Collins. But one thing that scares me is when you get that kind of money and you get married and then you get divorced, you have to keep singing because stuff like this happens. Phil Collins has an ex-wife. Phil Collins bought her a beautiful mansion in Los Angeles. She now runs an antique store in Los Angeles because, of course, she can't do anything productive with her life.
Hey! Don't insult antique store owners. They are my favorite kind of people in this world, and I will be one of them someday.
Well, when you marry that big, huge, rich, you know, marry Phil Collins and you can get one. Here's the deal, though, which is this scares me. So all of a sudden, she's now she likes to preserve old Hollywood mansions. Again, she can't collect stamps. She has to have a hobby that costs, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars.
Okay.
She finds out that a house down the street is going to be torn down and built into a mega mansion.
Mega mansion.
Okay, the house currently is worth $12 million. So guess what she did? She walked up to the people and said, "You cannot tear this house down." They go, "Well, the guy's going to come in. He's buying it. They met our price." They goes, "Well, what's your price?" She goes, $12 million. She goes, "I'll pay you $20." And the people said, "Sold." And Phil Collins said, "I gotta sing some more." Because Phil Collins, here's the other thing I read about him. He's been married, I believe, 3 times. He refuses to sign prenuptial agreements. He currently has
He thinks it's gonna work out. He's a hopeful person. That's very nice of him. It makes me like him a lot more.
His last marriage, which, by the way, he gets divorced, pays the woman $35 million. And now they're currently back together.
Aw.
The thing that just gets me is just like, I just saw him on Fallon. He doesn't want to sing anymore. He's an old man. He's been on tour since like the late 60s. He just wants to just be alone with his millions upon millions of dollars. But he's back singing the same songs. You want to know why? Because he's got wives who take up buying mansions as a hobby. And that just scares the heck out of me. That's when you ever see like a rock star, like this is no BS. About 2 years ago, no one thought Guns N' Roses was ever going to get back together again. Then I'm listening to Sirius and I'm listening to like one of the DJs and they say, guarantee Guns N' Roses is getting back together in the next year. And the guy sits there and goes, no way, they hate each other. They'll never talk to each other. He goes, I got the inside scoop. Slash just got divorced. Got taken to the cleaners. Trust me, anything that he has against Axl is now water under the bridge. A year later, they're back together
again. Wow.
If you ever want to know why some person's going back, like Phil Collins is going back on tour, guess why? Because his wife is buying mansions. He's got to find money somehow.
What Phil Collins should do, okay, if he doesn't want to sign prenups, he should, while they are married, suggest very like good hobbies that don't cost a lot of money. He should get interested in these hobbies with his wife so that after they're divorced, she can carry on these hobbies and, you know, just collect stamps instead of mansions.
See, I bet you he got her into antiquing. She's like, oh, let's go antiquing. Let's go on. Oh,
well, you don't have to buy mansions.
Well, I mean, again, antiquing's not cheap either. You're talking
about. But you don't have to spend $20 million. That's a little ridiculous. Yeah,
he's sitting there going, I gotta sing freaking more Genesis songs. Where are my guys from Genesis? Let's go back on tour. All right. Another one. You're a big beer fan. When you get rich, would you ever consider doing this? There was the most expensive beer ever created. Was it created this past week? $20,000 for a pint. Okay. And you had to drink it out of a dead squirrel. If you ever became a millionaire, like 100, this show took off, you became the biggest star in the world, and you had a decent amount of money, you being a beer aficionado, would you drink the $20,000 pint of beer out of the dead squirrel?
Hell no. First of all, I like squirrels. They're adorable. I don't want to ever drink anything out of a dead squirrel or even hold a dead squirrel unless I was consoling it or burying it, having a nice funeral. And I wouldn't spend that amount of money on anything.
There you go. Straight from Alex. So again,
stupid.
That is stupid. Now, another one that's stupid. Eric Clapton, I mentioned about like guys going back on tour. So I'm looking on Facebook yesterday and it says Eric Clapton is going on a North American tour. I'm like, cool. I like Eric Clapton. Let's see if he's coming to Pittsburgh. He's going to do 2 shows in Madison Square Garden and 2 shows at the Staples Center.
Okay.
That's it. I don't think that should constitute a tour.
It's a North American tour.
That's not a North American tour. That's not even, it's just, I'm doing a couple shows.
A New York
tour. Yeah, I'm just doing a couple shows. That's not a tour. I know Eric Clapton and his people love to watch this show. I'm looking right in the camera. Eric, it's not a tour. 10 cities minimum is a tour. That's the Mike Sasson rule. 10 cities minimum is a tour. All right, moving on. Last one.
That was beautiful.
That was good. All right. Barron Trump. Did you hear about this?
Nope.
Okay. So you saw the video of he was standing next to, by the way, Barron Trump, 10 years old, was standing next to his father after he won the election and was very stoic and just kind of was looking around, wasn't going nuts or anything like that. And through that, there was this kind of rumor that started that Barron Trump was actually autistic.
Because of the way that he was standing there.
Because he literally, they took the video of him standing there and more or less they went from it and did this whole video proving that because that he was standing in a certain way and he wasn't, emanating emotions or anything like that, that the future president of the United States' youngest son is autistic. Now, that's part one. Part two, Rosie O'Donnell, enemy of Donald Trump, then sends out a tweet going, is Barron Trump autistic? Be great if he was, because that would be wonderful for the autistic community because she's got an autistic kid and that would bring great, whatever to autism. Part three.
Should definitely word that differently. Yeah,
the Trumps come into the picture and says, we're going to sue Rosie O'Donnell because that's defamation and blah, 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 blah. So now we have the future First Lady of the United States claiming that she's going to sue Rosie O'Donnell because of that. And so Rosie O'Donnell recanted. Everything's over. And as we know right now, the little Trump kid is not autistic. The point I'm trying to make is we've got another 4 years of this, folks. All right. This is what we're going to get from it. All right. I'm going to leave you with this. I saw this last night. It was a man. All this is put as a very wise man gives good advice. All right. So this is part of the new segment called I'm going to leave you with this, which has its own theme song. Here's the theme song.
Love it.
Did you not have it potted up?
I did.
Okay. As always, remember, no matter whatever happens, it's the end of the world as we know it, and you will feel fine. All right? There you go. Boom. Because we don't want to pay REM either. They got too much money. All right. Literally, it says, very wise man, thank you for the advice. Here is the very wise old man giving very good advice.
A lobster is a soft, mushy animal that lives inside of a rigid shell. That rigid shell does not expand. Well, how can the lobster grow? Well, as the lobster grows, that shell becomes very confining. And the lobster feels itself under pressure and uncomfortable. It goes under a rock formation to protect itself from predatory fish, casts off the shell, and produces a new one. Well, eventually, that shell becomes very uncomfortable as it grows, right? Back under the rocks. And the lobster repeats this numerous times. The stimulus for the lobster to be able to grow is that it feels uncomfortable. Right? Now, if lobsters had doctors, they would never grow. Aww. Because as soon as the lobster feels uncomfortable, goes to the doctor, gets a Valium, gets a Percocet, feels fine, never comes off its shell. So I think that we have to realize is that we have to realize that times of stress are also times that are signals for growth. And if we use adversity properly, we can grow through adversity.
Wow.
I like that.
I just thought of lobster doctors and how adorable that is.
If you ever want to get inside of Alex's brain, she listens to this wise man tell you that, you know what, adversity is just, you know, it means that you're in a period of growth and that you should look at it as a positive way and you shouldn't look at it as a negative that, oh, why, woe is me. You're like, no, I'm expanding my horizons. I'm becoming a better person. No, she imagines a little lobster with her hit the white coat on and the little like the little light up there going into the sea and just be like, I'm a lobster doctor. By the way,
that's exactly how they would talk. And also that you can make anything sound wise if you put that piano music behind it.
I'm sure you could make anything. If you make it wiser, you could make it like
more wise.
More wise. You could, you know, if you sit there, you know, you have the guy who runs behind people and sits there and says, you know, the bleeper right in the pussy. I'm sure that guy wouldn't sound more wise if you played like magical piano behind it.
It depends on how you say it.
Okay. You're right. How did we say this show? I hope we got you through a little bit of your Tuesday or your Wednesday or your Thursday. Been finding a lot of people coming up to me and they'll say, hey, you know, I caught up with a lot of the shows. I don't know if you saw Nick Osman. Had a kid recently, a fan from the Q92.9 days, actually was not happy with you. Did you see the tweet? Basically sat there, you made fun of New Balance. And he says,
I don't retract my statement.
Okay, because he sat there and he sits there and he writes the tweet. He goes, I used to like Alex, now I have a problem with her. And he goes, hashtag, I wear New Balance because they're comfortable. But again, Alex sits
there. I'm okay with someone hating me for that.
He doesn't hate you. He just sits there and says, understand when you reach a certain level of old manness.
Of dadness.
It's all about comfort. Well, it's not about comfort here.
I'm just saying that you can't pick up women like that. That's all I'm saying. Go ahead and wear them. Don't try and pick up women. Or don't get sad that you can't pick up women because you're wearing New Balances.
Essentially, don't look and or act like a dad.
To pick up women?
Yeah.
Remember before how you said that those silence breaks, that's what makes the show?
Yeah.
That was it.
But I love the fact that it took you a little while. What does Mike mean? Oh, he's responding to the statement that Alex was making 5 seconds ago. Sometimes you break the computer. Hope we didn't break your computer today. It's the Mike Sasson Show. We'll be back next week with more just general wackiness. By the way, if you ever are in the Army and your general is general wackiness, you have to quit that. Okay, again on the River's Edge, www.riversedgepgh.com. Listen to all the great music, all the rest of the great shows. That is producer extraordinaire Alex. I'm very thankful for her. I'm very thankful for all of you. We'll see you next week. Bye.